What if you do Hillside is developed for school capacity and annexation, the water is stored both?
Depends what the annexation is.
It's small annexation.
As stated at 1250?
So at this point, if one of the other, or what's smaller, would be annexation?
Yeah, and this is a moving target, I mean, Hillside may come in less, more, I mean, this is a moving target, it's a growth limit.
And generally.
In general, we didn't have capacity for the Hillside, the Salish, and 1250, school.
Usually obligated to serve within municipal city limits first, so that's usually, you have development within the city, you have to plan for that first. And then if you can say, oh yes, full build out of the city, and then.
This is a running conversation, I mean.
Yes.
The other one I recorded, that's already good, we're gonna continue the conversation, bring it up. So why don't you move on to the next item we have?
Okay, next item real quick, there is a council seat that has been vacated. Case in point, we've had this conversation, you guys have been involved in the conversation, and we have the experience of things going around. Like, if you consider when the time for application, to look at your personal life and your balance, whether or not you want to apply for city council. Thank you, you guys have put the time in and had a experience, going through a lot of issues. I think that was it.
All right, we'll head back up. Mark, call me if you need me.
Thank you.
Ready whenever you are, sir.
We are, do we have a sign-in sheet?
Yes.
Okay.
The sign-in sheet for public comment or for, to receive information is over here.
Okay, thank you, Glenn. Let's go ahead and call this meeting to order for Tuesday, August 22nd at 7:04 PM. We'll start with roll call.
Commissioner Shakiro.
I'm here.
Commissioner Lizza.
Here.
Commissioner Fritz.
Here.
Commissioner Fritz.
Here.
Commissioner Fiddle.
Here.
Place is not here at the special meeting attention.
Mark, Commissioner Tice has excused. That brings us to item number three, approval of the agenda. As presented, any pleasure of the commission to have items of planning commissioner interest at the conclusion of our meeting? Add any additional items to the agenda? Otherwise, hearing none, we will approve the agenda as presented. And that brings us to item number four, which is citizen comments. Is there anyone here in the public that would like to speak to a topic that is not on tonight's agenda? Seeing none, we will move on to the open public hearing portion of our agenda tonight. Before we open the hearing, we have a presentation from staff that we should hear before the public comment period.
I prepared a formal presentation, mostly my points made at the previous 2 weeks ago Planning Commission meeting stand in terms of why we are proposing to move towards adopting the capital improvements program by reference rather than have the entirety of it in the comp plan. The three main reasons are that the current 2015-2020 CIP is outdated. The present CIP format is not in keeping with current city practice, and adopting the CIP by reference allows the CIP to be updated with the city budget moving forward. City budget approval requires its own legislative process, adding a protracted 60-day Department of Commerce review for comp plan program review that usually doesn't get any comment from the Department of Commerce, really just adds time on the city side when usually we already have the plan 2.5 to 3 months out after we've already got finalized construction documents to then move forward with construction. So this just makes the process simpler and easier and really allows the city capital program to work better with the budget process. So that's essentially, in a nutshell, why we're proposing these minor amendments. It removes an 18-page table from the plan, and then it makes changes to one paragraph, one page of the capital facilities on them. So I assume you read pack materials or reviewed them. If you have questions, you can entertain them in the discussion section prior to action.
Cool. With that, we will go ahead and open the public hearing. We have one citizen signed up to comment. Peggy, would you like to comment? Say, we would normally have a 3-minute time limit, but if you could keep your remarks to 5 minutes or so, or that'd be appreciated. Thank you.
All right. So I'm opposed to taking the CIP out of a comprehensive plan. While other cities have done this, their process is more evolved than the city's performance is. The residents need access and engagement with the city. The residents need to be able to have a dialogue regarding decisions. The city is not responding to many requests for information. What does keeping the CIP in the comprehensive plan do? Public participation is required for the CIP. If it is part of the comprehensive plan. Now the comprehensive plan lacks transparency and detail with CIP compared to the city's cost comprehensive plan with CIP. Snoqualmie either doesn't have a plan for public participation or doesn't implement it, which means that the city is not in compliance with the state's code regarding public participation. State law requires the city broadly disseminate to the public a public participation program identifying procedures, providing for early and continuous public participation, and the development and amendment of comprehensive plans and development regulations implementing such plans. State law only allows one change per year to the comprehensive plan with some exceptions, such as updates to the CIP. The city has not broadly disseminated a public participation program identifying procedures for participation to the comprehensive plan. The plan should be updated with public participation before using up their one opportunity for the year. Changes not in the amendment for the plan should be, as examples, status of Snoqualmie Hills annexation, Signal and Fisher and Snoqualmie Parkway citizens' concerns. Anything else that would be brought up by the community if they were aware of a process that should exist. What the public participation regulations for the CIP outside the comprehensive plan, what are they? At least there are regulations for public participation while the CIP is incorporated into the comprehensive plan. In finance committee meetings, they discussed the reasons staff would like to take the CIP out of the comprehensive plan while discussing CIP for utilities debt bonds of $45 million for the next 6 years, which actually will cost us $86 million when we get paid for the debt, and not require a vote of the residents. I was not allowed to speak for the most part. Begrudgingly, I was given permission to ask one question, but it was with a very long pause. Mayor Larson asked Bob James if Bob would allow me to ask a question. After some deliberation, Bob said, okay. I would not describe that exchange as an open discussion. Rather, exception to the rule, rarely residents are permitted to speak. For 2018-2019, Snoqualmie is considering a debt of $24.2 million for just utility CIP. Well, Issaquah is considering a total CIP debt of $12.9 million. These numbers are wildly out of line with each other, and the last thing we want is to have less public participation. This amendment requests adding a reference to RCW 3670-132A-IV associated with the following text. The capital facilities element and or CMP adopted by reference may be amended separate from the general comprehensive plan amendments concurrent with the adoption of amendment of the city budget. The code actually states. Amendments may be considered more frequently than once per year under the following circumstances. IV, the amendment of the capital facilities element of the comprehensive plan that occurs concurrently with the adoption of or amendment of a county or city budget. How does the amendment text associate or relate to the COOP? Some of the comments made during the finance committee meetings that were disconcerting, Thomas Tupper, Public Financial Management, this is really heavily funded with debt. So about 83% of this capital plan is assumed to be funded with debt. Tupper responded to what indicators does he see regarding bond interest trends? He says, looking at affordability of housing, points in time where housing was not affordable anymore. So that was a big indicator that something was wrong. Then it all came down to reasonable pricing again, affordable again. And now when I look at those charts again today, I see that it starts to be a negative trend. Larson, in response to Topwood, regionally, we're like San Francisco market, where we're almost recession-proof. We're being driven by increasing demand and lack of supply. This is, well, we're talking about $45 million in bond debt. This is wrong. In 2008, San Paulo was hit, like the rest of the country, with recession. And then later, Larson says, uncomfortable with option two or three, deciding on how they want to pull the money, but they're ready to go. Pruitt says, we absolutely have to do it. We're not sure what it is. Regarding a public process with a comprehensive plan, Pruitt says, I don't know that I was even aware that we had a docket process. Is there a formal time period that we would review the comp plan for this docket? Do we have some structure around this? And then in response to that, Hoffman says, North Bend has something where they put out a public notice in the newspaper. And then later, Hoffman says, my understanding from 2.5 years ago, the method was each January we would consider the city's needs and the community's needs and condense them if we had any discussion possibilities. In regard to how it would be easier to change the CIP, they said, one staff member said, without getting into the statutory requirements of the comprehensive plan. So City Gospel, public engagement. They had meetings for their 2018-2022 CIP. They had meetings between May and September. The state code says continuous public engagement or participation. So in their website, I can go there and I can look at their current CIP. I can look at their past CIP. I can find that on ours. And I looked at their one of their sessions, and it goes on for hours. And they spend a great deal of time responding to citizens' questions. So the code for the comprehensive plan public participation, RCW, Title 36, Chapter 36.70A, Section 36.70A.140, comprehensive plan, this is the text of the code, ensure public participation. Each city shall establish and broadly disseminate to the public a public participation program identifying procedures providing for early and continuous public participation in the development and amendment of comprehensive plan, use plans, and development regulations implementing such plans. Provision for open discussion, response to public comments. They don't have that identifying for the CIP. I have pie charts from City Gospel, funding sources. The only pie chart I got from the City of Issaquah was this. The red is funding, or borrowing money.
I'm sorry, what is the red?
Where you borrow money.
Can you read that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the first submit them for the record.
Here's the pie chart for the series. This is a total series. We're talking about total obligation or debt of $90 million when you pay it all out. And that's just part of the CIP, just the volume. That's not all of it. This is a total
concludes the list of attendees signed up to comment. Anyone else would like to, before we close the public comment period, would like to? And it's unfortunate before we close the public hearing that we had a room full of probably 25, 30 people last night that, whether or not, I'm not sure if they were signed up, but did we receive any email comments today by chance from folks that were not able to attend tonight? Okay. So with that, we will go ahead and close the public hearing. And we will move on to discussion. Questions from the commission? Be happy to start at the far end of the table and work down if that's the desire of the commission.
Yeah, I need some time to be able to.
Okay. Commissioner,
what's that? I have a few questions I'll have to do in part so that I have a chance to go. I don't want to take more time to allocate. By removing the CIP from the comprehensive plan, does that reduce the amount of review it gets, or does it increase, or does it change it in some way? Can you maybe give some elaborate on that as well? How is the CIP then reviewed in the future?
It just puts it in a different context. So if it occurs as part of changes annually with the capital facilities element of the plan as part of the budget process, there are public hearings that are statutorily required to be part of the budget process and to occur at a certain point in time of the year after publication of the paper. It's a very well established process that the council follows each and every biennium for the budget, and then for the mid-biennium if there are adjustments. So if the CIP is then reviewed and changed and discussed and debated in that process, it happens in that process as opposed to in a comprehensive plan review process. The differences are comprehensive plan amendments come before this body for a hearing, and typically not for a hearing in front of the council, which is the decision maker. And comprehensive plan amendments are required to be sent in advance for comment to the Department of Commerce, which typically does not offer any comment or review on capital facility element or CIP pieces in any event. So those are the differences. I would also note that I think there was an assumption made by the commenter that a CIP capital improvement program is a required part of a comprehensive plan. It's not. The CIP is a loose term used to refer to a whole slate of potential capital improvements. The capital facilities and element of a comprehensive plan is required by statute to address certain pieces, and the projects that it's required to address are only those that are needed to serve new growth and development. So the CFE is a limited subset of the things that are often addressed in a CIP, but a CIP is not required to be part of a comprehensive plan in the first instance. It's not even required by the growth management. So you heard a lot about sort of incorporating the GMA processes into the CIP, but they're not required.
Following questions while we're on that topic, that it would be helpful to understand. It seems as though that, at least from the staff position, trend, or that there's jurisdictions are moving towards incorporating by reference. I'm wondering, just on the flip side, what are, you know, some comparable cities that still have their, or be aware of the cities that have their capital facilities plan within their comprehensive plan?
I mean, I listed out the cities we looked at, which were Bellevue, Gowanus, Falkirk, and Montgomery, and Martinez, and Anderson. Those ones didn't have what we have, basically a bad long table. I didn't look beyond those.
That's fine. As a follow-up, then, if the CIP is not required to be in the comprehensive plan, how does it get reviewed then? And you mentioned it has reviews, but how is that? Is that a public process? Is that with public hearing and in front of which? Maybe just walk through the steps of the. I believe there was a flow chart for or I might be missing a bunch of, that was an SMP for the, for the colony, which doesn't apply to this.
Right.
Which we'll discuss when it's on the agenda. Maybe there's a, just a quick rundown of what that flow chart would be for, assuming if this moves forward and the CIP is removed, how is then that capital improvement plan reviewed?
Right.
In the future?
So.
And when, and specifically in relation to, public involvement?
Right, so generally, your initial CIP vetting process is done internally by staff. They review, so there's various capital plans that are maintained by the city. The city is somewhat unique, or at least not wholly comparable to other cities in that we operate our own water treatment and sewer treatment services. Whereas a variety of cities, and I'm not familiar with this, but a variety of cities offload some, portion of that or all of that to other larger utility managers like King County and so forth. So we operate our own plans, for utility programs. And then, there's also vetting of your roads and your park system as well and maintenance of buildings. So staff comes up with basically an initial list of the CI, the capital projects that are going to be required, and then creates a work plan, to vet those internally. And then, after they've sort of worked out the budgets with finance, it goes to city council for review. So council meetings are required to be open public meetings, so anyone can attend them, and their agendas are published online. But then the larger public process is generally right now done when it gets to council, which is more towards the, preparation for the ordinance to adopt the budget, in this case moving forward as opposed to adopting it with the comp plan. This year, the focus of the CIP update has been on the utility CIP update. There's lots of, capital programs that are being required by various overseers, like ecology, other state institutions, Department of Health, that, are basically coming down that, utility programs need to, accomplish those improvements to stay legal, basically. So, that's really been the focus of this year's update. Next year, the program is going to delve again more into the roads program and parks, and money, utility funding is obligated to be funded, on the same utility improvements. So your water utility funds have to be spent on water utility improvements projects, and or repaying, debt that has been assumed to accomplish those capital projects. And so right now what we've been doing is, in the towards the end, it sort of talks about this in the memo, we've been, working on developing a GIS platform that makes those capital projects easier for the public to see. We plan, I think, to expand the public access in terms of making it easier to see what's programmed. We haven't had a lot of input thus far on the table as it's been used to date, and we're trying to make it a little bit more viewer friendly. So that's sort of the transformation that's undergoing, accompanying this sort of transition out of being in the comp plan, which is, it's been pretty static in terms of, we haven't had a lot of input from the public on the comp plan. So I think not a lot of people go there, but a lot of people seem to watch the budget process. So that's the process to date, and sort of the sketch of the transformations that sort of been going right now. Did that answer your question?
Some of it. Okay. By moving the CIP out of the comprehensive plan, mm-hmm. it allows it to be reviewed more often.
Yes.
It allows it to be reviewed by citizens who attend city council meetings to speak to that, which has been public notice in advance. Yes. Is it reviewed? I mean, according to, it talks about going in front of the community development committee meeting on to, on September 5th, the
right.
City Council Community Development.
Yeah.
Is that our open public hearing then?
No.
The open public meeting.
Open public meeting.
Right, I'm wondering.
Typically, the committees do not hold hearings, the council holds hearings. In this case, it went, because it's still a comprehensive plan related, it went to the Community Development Committee. I would anticipate in the future the things related to the CIP would likely be handled by the Parks and Public Works Committee rather than the CD Committee. And then in front of the full City Council, where as part of the budget there is required public notice and public hearings that happen by specified dates prior to the end of the biennium and the start of the next, or start of the next. So that those happen on a well-established schedule that's set by statute.
Okay. And just to clarify, there's two parallel processes happening. So this is maturing through the CD committee on into council, which is basically amending the comp plan. At the same time, what's coming through public works is the new incoming CIP, which focuses
right.
on that utility
upgrade. Right, and that's because it's technically still an integral part of the comprehensive plan. It has to get approved by council to be removed from the comprehensive plan
and then adopted
separately by reference, and then the modified CIP, which is being processed.
And then, in fact, it's the subject of tonight's FNA committee meeting upstairs right now.
Yeah.
And obviously, the city council wants to pay a fair amount of attention to the project list, given that many of them are going to be the subject of conversation around whether, when, and how much debt to issue.
Okay. Last question, I'll pass along and then you're right to ask more. Under the next steps, you've indicated that they're anticipated for two meetings with City Council review and petition, September 11th and September 25th.
Right.
Will those both being open public meetings, will those also be noticed at a public hearing for comment from the public?
Probably not, because this body, for comp plan related things, it's this body typically that holds the hearings, a recommendation, and then to council. I'm sure that they will take public comment.
Yeah.
Okay. But they don't then rehear things that have been heard by this body in terms of publishing notice as paper and so on.
So now we do this comment as part of our recommendation to council. I'm going to proceed on the assumption that it would be appropriate for us to recommend that council does take public comment as part of it due to the lack of quorum yesterday. Participation was at a different level than it is today. An effort to make sure that those folks that want to give public comment can be heard, and council can hear that then as part of that session.
And as you probably know, the council's practice is to take general public comment at the start and at the end of each council meeting, and to take public comment on specific agenda items when they're called. So certainly you can recommend, you know, that they do that.
That they continue to follow the procedure they currently apply.
Right, but we would certainly anticipate that's what would happen. Yes. Okay,
good.
Thank you.
I think as I understand it, one of the benefits of this body, we're removed from the funding competition. Actually, we don't have insight into debt issuance and what timing, prioritization of projects, right? That's something that we're removed from. It's not part of our purview as a planning commission. Is that right?
Correct. Yeah, budget, finance.
Budget, finance, any of okay.
Staffing.
And that would be another reason for adopting by rapidly going for committee review and approval versus commission.
Yes, they're charged with that review and action. So
that's more appropriate at that level that is still in the comprehensive plan by reference.
Sorry for interrupting, take some of your time, but that is a good point, that it is still by reference. It's not removing the CIP from the comprehensive plan, it's just doing it by reference, in which case then it can be updated, amended, and modified when necessary, so it doesn't run into the situation where it falls out of date, or it doesn't meet the 6-year requirement.
And on top of that, I think my comment would be, I'm not sure what, you know, how functionally this would work. But my hope would be that when, if we're a document that's attached by reference, that there's some, you know, easy to find link on the homepage, that it's not, or on the website, that you know, when they say as an account plan or something, that's easy to see what's attached. Sometimes when they say by reference, it's hard to put the whole
thing. Yeah, the visualization is hard to explain, but as we move to a new website and that project matures, it'll essentially look like a map with symbols on it. And as you scroll over the symbol, it takes you to the actual project that has the short description, the budget language, the need, and so that information is all linked together. So you don't have to go to a series of documents and read each document to figure out what's going on. It's a way to meet those up instantly. So if you live on Northern Street and there's a little symbol on Northern Street, you'll get that project's information. Or you can cruise through and look at all the symbols. All would be represented on that GIS map.
Also, just to follow on Commissioner Lestay's comment, in terms of adopting it by reference, the other thing that's happening is that adoption by reference is being placed in the capital facilities element, because the statute has that exception for the thou shalt not amend your comp plan more than once per year, except you can do it more than once per year if you're doing it as part of the budget with changes to the CFP. So that those things happen at the time of the year where the council is making other fiscal related decisions and can consider the projects along with the budget and the appropriations when it makes the most sense, without then also jeopardizing the annual docket process for citizens to make requests for other changes to the company. And that's, I think the commenter has not looked at the code, but that docket process is specified.